High Bridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Yellow Rain Poems by Mai Der Vang. Read by Mai Der Vang. Because as long as these words live, you will not die. And if the acid of time and warlike tempests pull them down, you will not die. And we will not die again. Raul Sarita, Enri. I have been following the rains, hunting them in my dreams. Yellow rain, biological warfare, the Hmong, erasure of a people's history, negation of trauma, shadows and truth. First came the wars that led to other wars, that led to the secret war that became a proxy war in 1960s Laos, led by the Central Intelligence Agency. The white foreigner arrived bearing guns and bombs to lead his surrogate cause, to quell communism and use Hmong men to do his work of war. In breach of Laos's neutral state and a deepening of secrets. 1975. The war came crumbling down, and all was lost to the communist victors of Vietnam and Laos. Almost everyone fled, deserting what was once home. Yellow rain came in the midst of exodus. Poison landed on the Hmong in the middle of escape. Specks descending from aircraft overhead, falling onto trees, into water, and onto skin. Specks of a mysterious substance ranging in color, red, black, white, green, and yellow above all. Specks of illness and death. I am a daughter of Hmong refugees. Mother and father were among the fled, which makes me among the fled. Second child and firstborn in a new land. Daughter who keeps looking back at the sky. Guide for the channeling. Toward a worn legacy of rain, I have been lost down every jungle path. Adrift and senseless to split open a cascade of knowing. I have tried with all my limber to keen a credo of justice, shelter those who solace inside graves. I have been boiled in my bladed search, opening with questions of a deserted pain, to end with a cemented breath shattered into silk. This is where I am taking you, into a discarded vista blowing forth a silent blaze. Here in sunk villages of the disregarded. Here where even the dirt of the land cannot muster against the threat of air. Biomedical, vegetation, munitions unfound, every footprint incarnate. Where highlands tangle their echoes to the ground, a place no matter how remote will always be too near and too much a reminder of an expired war. Refugees not called as people only to be called the outcome of an event. We are venturing into swell beyond swelling of paperwork and protocol, slips of memo and routing, cable and classified meeting. Here's the talk. Biological weapon, yellow spots, apiary blame for decades to wane and cold filed. Believe me as a torch of this wandering that I have been digging within the origins of redaction. Believe where I am sending you. I have been shoveling upside down, and now my eyes stagger, my hands ache, my legs becoming hunter, my back a raging shadow. I have been gardening myself into this remembrance. Declassified. May the dead be ever evidenced. May their clandestine names bellow from the mouth of an August monsoon. May they coax the truth from every storm. Long ago, there lived a jungle whose only cloth was camouflage. All those who came to it learned the burden of hiding. Long ago, we memorized the refrains of wild birds, stitched them underneath our evacuated skins. Then man, then soldier, then vividness of saffron and canary arriving as small showers, divulging its anatomy to the ecosystem. To keep the covert buried is not how this story bends. The insects have always known. Their lineage of pollen and the children of insects know too. May this secret war, its author of poisons, its professor of counterfeit treaties, kidnapper of honeybees, each iota of its polluted doing, may it all burn and blister under its own nakedness. The fact of the matter is the consequence of ugly deaths. It's not fair to not consider other stories, other frames of the story. Ronald Reagan used this story to order the manufacture of chemical weapons. First time in 20 years. If the United States were to manufacture chemical weapons again, use them because the Russians supposedly had, people would have died ugly deaths in the consequence. Robert Coleridge, Radiolab, WNYC, September 23rd, 2012. Out here, it's parlors of jungle. Sometimes flashbacks of disfigured interrogations. Handprints fleeing to leave no crease behind. This is our monsoon to shelter. Our version of mortality snaking toward delusional truth. We know how to let go, then perish with even more lineage of beauty. For thickening of truces between false men, aging purveyors of genetically modified diplomatics, lizard citizens invented, herbicidal biomediation, whistling riddles into an arsenal of hammers, spit of your unhinging. You refuse our dead as though we were never alive. Just say what you mean to say, that is, Hmong, keep your dying to yourself. Anthem for Taking Back. Even after what shrivels on pillows are the syllables of a dream, and our braided furies huddle under porch light, after skyline of lashes close over our ocular machines, and a lightlessness governs the way we move our arms. Long from now, how every breath turns out a copy of the air before, and all air moves through us as cotton. What we heed after a fluorescence capes the skin of our early moon. Whatever be the scourge thumping inside our ears. Ember our wings out of exile, it says. Ember loudly all of our furious tellings. They think our killed ones cannot speak to us. As if to adjourn all oxygen from the neck is how they try to take the voice. As if attempts to render us pale, ripped lungless from woke into wild ash. As if ashes cannot blink, howl, testify with the pulse of their own tatters. As if hymn and whistle, hail and pour. We've seen how they shame the light. Stripped hollow, tearing out filigrees of stars from protocols of dust to make drink a bouquet of venom sprayed down a constellation's throat. They must be so earless as if we've no legs to kneel. We are each other's memory of the future 40 years from here, arriving at ourselves by way of the dead. History will not beget powder, will not beget myth, will not make us into marginalia. As ever possessed by what we have lost, there are no language barriers in the afterlife. A toxin is a toxin is a toxin is the man-made truth, is the dead who leave everything behind. These bodies under the rains. Vomiting, nausea, diarrhea, respiratory issues, chest pains, dizziness, blurred vision, blisters, and lesions. Cases of hemorrhaging and bloody diarrhea culminating in death. I think of them not only battling an enemy, but also battling their own bodies. Then the unknowable. The truth buried in the jungles. How do you elude the shape of something you cannot name? Attacks came through the dry seasons and even at times during the wet, aimed primarily at remote areas like Pubia, a mountainous refuge for the Hmong resistance. In some cases, whole villages perished. The State Department reported more than 6,000 died from yellow rain. Some scholars and human rights organizations contend a larger number, possibly 20,000 to 40,000 Hmong casualties. Fingers were pointed at and allegations denied by the Soviet Union, charged with backing the communist governments of Vietnam and Laos. Yellow rain had fallen before and would fall again. Claims surfacing elsewhere. During the Yemeni Civil War of 1963 to 1967, against the Khmer Rouge soldiers, attacks on Mujahideen resistance fighters, Azerbaijan, Mozambique, the Iran-Iraq War, a substance with many aliases, places of historical use, potential origins, but stealth enough to never be rooted. A body always yours. It felt like a knife in the ribs, as if their body was going to blow up. The teeth to feel loose and the gums to smell rotten. Anyone whose bare skin was touched by a droplet to suffer severe necrosis of the affected area, died as a result of the rotting of their skin, took about 2 weeks to die. Native medicine was used to counter the effect, was made from an infusion of sugarcane, a green-skinned, pumpkin-like gourd and opium, carried in bamboo containers. Cable, November 20, 1979, report questionnaire, attachment, February 13, 1980. For what will be the chrome of your ribs? A coronation faceted to the bead of your bones cameo. For how you will asylum your incisors into the clay of your jaws. For the terrarium of another day. You do not need to crumble. You will not distort from the shape you've always been. All pieces of you together. As ever at birth, all pieces elixired with sugarcane, gourd, tonic of opium. Elixired from a call to grow arms, it will not take a severed meadow to publish your ransacked gown. Rest apart the sprouting of an armory to mend this scarred biology. You will not be unheeded, if only to banner the truth. Gather now your pigments and resist. Endure beyond a fortnight. Ill of the dubious. Pork poisoned, appetite of contamination. poised for refugees to consume, in the nation next door for persons misplaced. Poisoned pork, or pork contaminated, was fed to Hmong refugees, in a camp for the campless, in a place called Nong Khai, on day 4, on day 5, in the month of April in the year 79. Hmong refugees ate the poisoned pork from the bad hogs butchered in the abattoir, given them by camp workers, who all ate from the same hogs, where persons 3,000 who ate from the bad hogs were Hmong inside the camp of Nong Khai, at which vomit dealt to over 500, at which alongside with diarrhea of severity, detriment to the vision, at which there was penchant for sleep. So children, total 8, adults, 5 of them died. 8 children and 5 adult Hmong refugees died from eating poisoned pork fed to them in the camp at Nong Khai. While numerous at the camp who ate of the same but affected others were not, but affected were only Hmong. When poisoned pork was fed to Hmong refugees and some of them died. From bad hogs slaughtered on night before into 0800 hours meal of next day. Then 2 hours after, a man confessed of heavy head, muscle unrest, eyes to pop, dizzy with unable to sight, as others in the camp at Nong Khai ate the contamination, as soup with small pieces of pork had fewest effects than ones who ate bad pork thrown into stir-fry. Then most wildly poor outcome for refugees who fed on entrees containing blood of bad hogs. In other cases, Hmong refugees given vegetables dusted in white powder, flavor of mysteriously unkind. As again, when powers in camp of Nong Khai fed poisoned cabbage with unknown bitter to Hmong refugees, but complain and maybe just crave, but complain and was told, don't eat it then, but to shrivel and thirst you in your days as a person misplaced in a camp for the landless, in a place where they stored you, served into fear, won't come your mouth to the spoon. When the poison fell, before 1979. 1. Hmong refugee, age 26, heard about attacks, March 1976, Ban Nong Kui, 28 dead, red, green, and yellow smoke, September 1979, Ban Nam Kai, 27 dead. You have followed how deep the ear-telling proceeds, undensing these patterns to widen a vacancy of clues, to hear as you've heard into the pulp's undergrowth. How much archiving is too much sintered and fatigue? How digested the headlights flare over the diseased hymn? 2. Hmong medic, age 24, treated victims who experienced attacks, 1976 to 1977, 49 villagers from Puchia. Last patient came to him in March 1977, all died within 24 to 48 hours, symptoms of red, swollen eyes, bitter taste in mouth, convulsions, chest pain, difficulty breathing, darkened faces, stiff necks, excessive flow of saliva. Those who ended with you, toiled from hideouts of crowded thorn, crashed out of ridgeline only to collide in a courtyard of exposure. Those who clawed along without fragrance of honey in their mouths, nor memory of stillness, nor enamel of face as an unchanged shade of Hmong. Those who wandered your way, would you have fed them remedy of ancestors or stray petitions arriving into gravity? What little you could bestow but a repairing face, triage of prayers. 3. Hmong refugee, aged 35, witnessed attack, September 1979, Van Palu. Bombs landed 10 meters from him, gray and yellow smoke, some of them did not go off, dark green artillery shell-like, dark green cylindrical canister, unable to identify lettering because he is illiterate. Saw two people exposed who died within 2 days, coughing up blood, runny noses, severe bloody diarrhea. An additional 20 more people were killed in this attack. He himself got sick, chest pain, cough, pain in eyes, stung like hot peppers when he tried to breathe. Bring up your eyelids to meet the horizon's climb. Even as the carcinogen of a dire spice cauterizes you to remember. An aching encounter with the faded two bound to the wild mist, where munitions occurred 10 meters away, 10 meters from complicit artifacts awash in a lettered truth, 10 meters from crouching of proof. 4. Hmong refugee, age 56, experienced attack, early 1978, Puchia. Two L-19 bombs were dropped on his village, red and black smoke. 6 relatives died. He was told that he fell unconscious for 7 days within 30 minutes after attack. He felt bad after regaining consciousness. Fingernails and toenails were black from hemorrhage. Tongue stiff and could not talk for 7 days. Lost vision for 30 days. How can a ceiling of translucence lift from a ground so routinely sombered it has no Fahrenheit in which to hibernate? The lemongrass might blade at first touch, but take a labor of calm to salve your hands. Feet giving back its truest blush. Take that you lived and were offered the backbone to tell. Lessons on arriving at the perimeter of a miracle. They are yours to keep, as this falling out of and back into have been yours to nestle. Debris of the last epiphany, ever yours to fulfill. A daub of tree swallows as aerial ash. Most serious charge, however, relates to report of massacre committed on May 15, 1985, in which approximately 5,000 civilians were ordered into a cave at UG332820 and were gassed. These civilians reportedly were captured at UG332803 on May 14th, following a May 13th battle in which resistance fighters suffered heavy casualties at hands of Vietnamese and Pathet Lao soldiers. Some 25 intended victims reportedly escaped being driven into cave. Our efforts to date do not enable us to confirm any details of incident. Cable from the U.S. Embassy, Bangkok, to the Secretary of State, September 3, 1985. All over threnodies of dissected water. Inside this cavern of scars. Had the barn owl been more accepting to tell? Had your sonatas peddled from below the walls of this resounding abyss? Questioning what yielded in your conduit of husk. They cannot be sure of details in preference to dismiss in fear of the knives sewn into their bones. They offer no place for you but here is a place to rest your evening bird song. Alongside a river of windows, under a trellis of bells to nourish in silk leaves and a harvest of wild pears. Case Studies in Escape, post-1975. 1. Hmong Village Chief. 5 times your village was forced to roam, restless and uprooted by eyes of the regime to settle in the Bandon Valley. Wise ones taken to seminar meant this was a land of rules. No farming in the lowlands, no contact with the locals, no hunting within the forests, no trade outside the settlement, no clinics, no schools, no elders allowed to spirit lead.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.